Hi everyone, I'm Valentin. I work for Google Cloud Platform. Today I'll talk about performance, and I'll talk about performance of software written in Go, running in a public cloud. What I say today applies in general to most cloud computing performance concerns and most Go programming. It is not specific to a vendor. However, my example will be illustrated with the Google Cloud Platform architecture. First, I'll share my insights about what we want to optimize and why. Then we'll see how we can observe the performance of cloud architecture and discover which components best explain the actual latencies experienced by our users. Then we'll have a look at how we can observe and improve the performance of components written in Go. And finally, I'll share my list of top 10 favorite performance problems and solutions. What is performance tuning? So it's usually about working on something slow and making it faster. So pretty simple. Why are we doing this extra effort? We might want to increase the throughput and to decrease the cost. But today, I'm focusing on the most important goal, which is to offer a better user experience. Human seconds are more precious than machine seconds. Users have very high expectations of speed, and if they experience a sluggish service, then they'll be frustrated and they will leave, obviously. The architecture of a new software system designed for a certain level of performance is always the result of theory and experience and intuition. They reflect what kind of latency we should expect in theory. However, measurements are more relevant as soon as the system exists, even before its initial release. And measurements often contradict intuition. I'm an experienced developer and I have intuitions. Well, most of the time they are dispelled by the actual numbers. So on one hand, I get frustrated that my super smart intuition turned out to be dead wrong. And on the other hand, I'm happy and grateful that my measurements finally provided me with insights closer to the reality. There is an interesting correlation between code quality and performance. Making your code clearer and more decoupled also makes it faster at first. On the other hand, the more you push your quest for performance, the more you will resort to hacks and complicated code. It's a trade-off. How far are you willing to go? Now, improving the performance is not a great deal if we break the correctness. Designing strong automated tests is necessary in order to make optimization refactoring without introducing regression bugs at the same time. A quick poll. Do you know the difference between service time and response time? Anyone? Okay. These 100 milliseconds here are the time it took for the service to process one incoming request. This is the service time. But it might very well be that the latency experienced by our user was actually 700 milliseconds. The user may have a slow connection, or the request could be waiting in a queue while the server instance is already working at full capacity. This total latency is the response time, and it is always bigger than the service time, as it also includes the network latency and the queuing time. The point is, I'm mixing the slides. Okay, why am I saying all this, and what does it have to do with Go software? Let's illustrate with blue hexagons representing server components in Google Cloud. Go programs are usually server components. The server components are where we have the most accessible information about performance, the server logs, the server traces, etc. But it's too easy to fool oneself into thinking that when the server is fast, then magically the whole system is fast and the users are having a pleasant, seamless, responsive experience. That is simply not true. This is how looking only at server latencies of an internal application at Google, I didn't even notice that an important page was taking 30 seconds to render. So The user was staring at a blank screen, completely unresponsive, while the JavaScript was performing UI repaint over and over for some reason. And I had no idea because that was completely invisible in the server monitoring. The first step to achieve some meaningful and valuable performance is a sane architecture that takes into account the client device workload, the browser cache, the network latency, and the number of network round trips. We should leverage used metrics from the browser and not rely on the server metrics only. In the recent years, quite a lot of the workload and of the latency has shifted from the server side to the client side, and we should take this fact into account. More generally, focusing on the user is a good idea. I can't ever overemphasize this axiom, users first. Now let's have a look at some observability tooling available in a public cloud. We can usually view the access logs of all incoming requests, decorated with the applicative logs and the latency. The latency is, of course, the service time. It's super useful, but remember that it's only a fraction of the response time because the server doesn't really know the full story, only what happens server side. If we are lucky, we can click on the latency and view the waterfall of all the API calls that happened during the processing of this request. I love waterfall charts. They provide with so much insight in a single view. The trace view shows me for a given request what API calls were made, in which order, how long they took, and if they were sequential or concurrent. I can also view the applicative logs here and here and here, right inside the waterfall diagram. This is actually a great feature for observability. The spans tell me what happened, and the logs can tell me why. In this specific example, the total latency of 62 milliseconds consists almost entirely in one data store entity read and two data store queries. We also have a few read and write access to memcache, but those are super fast. Now I know that the bottleneck is the data store, and there's no point in trying to speed up my memcache operations. You can also notice that the last two data store queries are running concurrently, which is a good idea when it's possible. If you're using Google Cloud Platform, I strongly encourage you to set up the automatic export of all of the logs to BigQuery. In BigQuery, you can use SQL to query fine-grained performance insights over large or short periods of time, and also you have a much longer retention period in BigQuery than in a style driver logging, for example, which flushes after 30 days only. So I will show you the backend of a website written in Go, running on a Google App Engine standard. So it's a website about programming idioms, and we can see the last requests that were made. We should see some access to the static resources, for example, CSS, JS, and those should be super fast, 1 millisecond, 1 millisecond, etc., because on App Engine standard, static files are served in a CDN manner, close to the user, and not using the App Engine instances at all. And here I can click on a page that took 67 milliseconds to serve, and I can view the trace details. So 60 milliseconds only, I guess the page should have been in memcache, yes. We can see that most of the latency was spent in memcache and maybe a little bit in executing the template, that is generating server-side the HTML. And if that specific page was not in the cache, then I would have seen some access to the data store here, and it would have probably taken more than 100 milliseconds. So that was just to give you a quick overview of the waterfall choices available in Google, in the Google Cloud Platform console. Cool. I already have set up a sync, which is a setup of an export of all the logs to BigQuery. So now I can query, I can ask questions in BigQuery, like in the month of October, what were the most frequently accessed pages, what was the average latency, and the worst case latency. It's usually pretty fast to have an answer from BigQuery within seconds. So the home page was accessed this month 7,000 times. It took on average only 42 milliseconds. Can you read from the back? It's, the details don't matter actually. And the max experience latency server side was over 2 seconds, maybe a cold start, I'm not sure. The second most popular page was the RSS page, because some clients must pull the RSS, I guess, which was accessed 2,000 times. And once again, only 75 milliseconds on average, but it took up to 3 seconds. So in BigQuery, I can gain some insights about what is slow, what is more important, what has some variance, and basically, what should I optimize? Okay, let's get back to the slides. A waterfall like this one is the best view to understand the latency of a component. In this simple example, 100% of the server latency of a request, the service time, not the response time, consists in 6 sequential calls to external services. The service works well, but everyone agrees that it is a bit slow. Here I can see 4 opportunities for improvement. First, I now have a better idea of the latency of each of my dependencies. If my database is expected to respond in under 100 milliseconds, but my measurements show that it is each query actually is taking 200 milliseconds, then I know that something should be fixed in the external database. So maybe create a SQL index, and if I'm lucky, I just speed up the database accesses without changing anything in the server code, only by doing ops on the database. And the total latency has just been reduced a bit. Next opportunity, look at the calls to service B. I often witness repeated access to the same service with different parameters and payload. It is a law of the universe that if a service accepts batch calls, that is, if it accepts many commands but in a single API call, then the batch call will be faster than the sum of the individual calls. Here we are calling service B 3 times sequentially with different parameters, 1, 2, 3, but we can do better. By transferring the same amount of inbound and outbound data and asking for the same amount of work to service B, but in a single API call, we suddenly improved the total latency. This may sound counterintuitive. However, it makes perfect sense because some heavy costs like network latency, component authentication, etc., are now paid only once instead of 3 times. We sometimes achieve this optimization by wrapping the commands in a transaction. However, batching and transactions are different concepts. Transactions are about atomicity, while batching is about achieving economies of scale. This is what batching can look like when using a Go client library. Instead of 3 sequential calls storing each 1 key entity pair, we prepare a slice of keys and a slice of entities, and then one single API call to the batch func put multi. So the code change is not very complex, we just need to know that it happens to make things faster. Most of the time, it is also true that making a few expensive API calls concurrently is faster than doing them sequentially. In my case, the calls to service B are logically completely independent from the database calls and from the email operation. So I can decide to run service B concurrently and save some milliseconds. The three other operations depend on each other's completion, so I can't run them all concurrently. As the batch call to service B starts immediately, and it is already finished when the email has been sent, it's effectively become free. The total duration here is the same with or without the call to service B. For this simple example of parallelizing two independent blocks of code, I suggest to use a wait group. I don't recommend channels for this because the channel's details are subtle and tricky to get right. So wait groups are straightforward. There are only three methods to know. Add to increment, done to decrement, and wait to let the main goroutine move on when all the tasks are completed. Now for the next opportunity, please ask yourself if the email sending operation is more synchronous or asynchronous by nature. I suggest that we postpone the work of sending the email after having sent the HTTP response to our human users, once again saving precious human milliseconds. If you have full control of your server instance, then it's super easy to launch this background work as a new goroutine. But if you're in a managed serverless environment, however, it may be restricted and not possible to do any further work after the HTTP request has been processed. In this case, you'll have to use an asynchronous task queue. Deferring some work with task queues is more code than just launching a new goroutine. You have to create an asynchronous task, and which typically involves serializing some parameters into the payload of an HTTP request that will be processed here by another handler of your app. Now let's pause and see the result. A total of 200 milliseconds instead of 900, that's a huge win. And you can see that we achieved this without using any low-level assembly code, and without upgrading the underlying hardware, and without even caring if we have one or many CPU cores. Now a small interlude to say that we should take our measurements with a grain of salt. In general, it is most useful to run the performance test on the same machine configuration as used in production. Keep in mind that public clouds offer virtual machines, which are convenient, but don't give you full control over the underlying hardware. Even if you achieve very good average latencies, you may experience higher variance than with dedicated hardware. This may perturb the tests, and in some cases, this may perturb the user experience. Here is a demo of a CPU and memory intensive web app written in Go. It creates a mosaic in which each tile is a colored cat. My input image is a lion from Reading, and the little cat was drawn by myself. So I will build a build cat out of little cats. How will I do that? Okay, the web app is hosted on Google App Engine standard on the smallest configuration F1. I need to specify two parameters, the resolution of a tile in pixels and the number of tiles that will make the width of the resulting mosaic. So let's generate an horizontal tile of 20 cats. I'm not even sure I do have the lion on my hard drive. That would be a fail. I don't have it, it's somewhere here. Sorry about that, I should have prepared better. So, reading, and we have. That's a big fail. Okay, let's take Mona Lisa instead. Ah, really sorry about that. I don't have the JPEG. Oh, the Defentus, that's a nice one. Have you heard of that one? Okay, so I'm generating a bus. but I will show you what it would have given with the reading layer, I promise. Okay, so this is a DevFest bus, but we can't even recognize that it's a bus. So I will now generate it again, but with a better resolution of, let's say, 120 cats. Where is my... Okay, my mouse is here.
So is it just mapping it to the different colors?
Actually, I'm coloring the little cat with the average color of what's underneath in the big picture. Okay, so what will happen with the highest resolution, 120 cats, server error. That's part of the demo, trust me. Okay, let's look at the logs. So that should be real time in theory. Mosaic cat, yes. And here the processing function said exceeded soft memory limit of 256 megabytes. That's a small instance F1 in Google App Engine standard, which is quite small. I can't generate a huge image with that. So I deployed the same application, but on the instance class F4 with 1 gigabyte of RAM, of memory. Let's open it in a separate tab. Okay, and on this one, I should be able to generate a big mosaic. So this, while it's generating, I should find the lion. Where is the lion? I had it. Is it generating something in my back? I can't see. Great. Here it is. So I can copy it here. So it worked. And if I can I zoom back with that thing? I should have brought a mouse. I can't do that with a trackpad. Oh, you can see that it's nice. So we achieved actually vertical scalability. We just upgraded the underlying instance class and it worked. So now if I... where is my mouse? I can't find it. Okay, so I did find the lion. Let's see what it gives. Yes. If it took 10 seconds for the Mona Lisa picture, it should take about 10 seconds for the big lion. Suspense, excitement. Yeah. How many of you are from Reading? Is it a very famous statue?
Yeah.
Okay, very cool. I can see its bottom.
Yeah, there's more than that there as well.
Okay. Cool. And if I click, you can see that it's indeed made out of thousands and thousands of little kitties. Great. Let's get back to the slides. Okay. So that was a poor resolution lion. That was supposed to be the high resolution lion, still made out of kitties. And if I wanted to print it in a 3 meters high poster, while still keeping a very high resolution for each little kitty, then I wouldn't do this with App Engine standard. I would maybe need some even bigger hardware, and we'll get back to that in a few minutes. That one is not supposed to happen. Okay, a word about serverless and cold starts. Where is my mouse? I can't believe that. So cold starts are a true performance concern in serverless applications. A cold start is a request response time that is much higher than usual because the server is warming up. And the Go servers tend to have fast cold starts mm-hmm. because they don't need a JVM, for example. And thanks to the standard library, they usually don't need hundreds of megabytes of dependencies. All of my applications written in Go, for example, they all have a cold start that is under 2 seconds. Less than 2 seconds to start a virtual machine and boot the operating system and start my server. Trust me, that's a pretty good cold start. And it's not always the case depending on the environment and the programming language and the libraries that we decide to use. So Google announced Cloud Run this year at Next in San Francisco, which lets you deploy your own Docker containers to a serverless platform. With Cloud Run on GKE, more specifically, you can achieve vertical scalability by choosing your custom machine types with more memory and more CPU cores. And this solves my problem of generating a huge mosaic file and printing it to a 2 meter high poster in high resolution. True story. So now let's have a look at the Go tooling. The tools I'm going to show are not specific to the cloud. They can run on your development laptop, or they can run on virtual machines as well. It's perfectly fine to do some performance exploration on your own computer, but remember that it's more relevant to run them in the production environment. Also, the measurements in production sometimes dispel the workstation measurements, as well as my best intuitions. In Go, this is how you run the automated tests. All Go programmers are familiar with this command line. I encourage to explore performance in test files, as the standard testing package plays very nicely with the performance tooling. This is how you run your benchmarks, integrated in the Go test subcommand with an additional flag. This is a powerful performance feature of the Go tooling. You write 2 benchmarks calling functions A and B respectively, and then you will discover which one is the fastest. Faster. Here are 2 functions, A and B. Can you read or not really? I will zoom a bit, maybe. They are trying to do the same thing, to determine if the word is contained in this long article. So function A is using a regular expression for this that is already compiled only once. And function B is using the standard library function strings.contains. So, I will now run the tests and the benchmarks. Nope. I should click inside that. Yes. And the tests are passing. Yes. More specifically, test A passed and test B passed. That's good to know. Now let's run the benchmarks. So, what is that telling us? It's telling us that function BA just ran 10 million times on my laptop, and it took 200 nanoseconds per operation on average. And function B, which is trying to achieve the same thing, ran 20 million times and took 100 nanoseconds on average. Which means that in this specific example, the standard library function string.contains, code inside B, is twice as fast as using a regular expression, which is good to know if that code is in your hot bath. Benchmarks give raw number. Now we'll see 2 graphical visualization tools. Trace is an execution tracer. It works by instrumenting the program to produce a binary file containing the activity of each CPU core over a period of time. Is it idle? Is it running the garbage collector? Is it running a function? And what is the call trace? This is a CPU-bound sequential task. You can see that only one of my CPU cores is active and the other ones are idle. It turns out that the same sequential computation may be dispatched over several CPU cores by the Go scheduler of the Go runtime. This doesn't involve any concurrency. Only one CPU core is running at any given time. And now this is an example of a concurrent computation using several goroutines. You can see that all the cores are busy. This can be good or bad, but it doesn't mean that the program is efficient. Having a lot of goroutines communicating and synchronizing with each other can lead to contention and to a lot of expensive context switching. Here, I guess I have quite a lot of context switching going on. Quite often, an inappropriate granularity of the goroutines can lead to worse performance with four CPU cores than the same sequential task on one CPU core. The best multi-core performance is achieved when each goroutine performs a fair amount of sequential work before writing the result to a channel or releasing a new text or decrementing a wait group. So I will show the execution trace of the benchmark of the CAT model processing package. It's quite small. Let's run the benchmarks with an extra flag trace to produce a binary file a.out. Even if you can't read, it's not too bad, but yes, I'd like you to see the syntax. Go test, bench, trace. It's kind of important. But the numbers are not important. The numbers are a little bit skewed by the instrumentation. All I care about here is the visualization, which I open with go to trace. HTTP 6060, that's for my window on the right, and using the file that I just produced, a.out. So that's what happened during the benchmark of the CAT mosaic generation. My computation is sequential, which is one, we can see only one processor running at any given time. And if I ask what was it doing at this specific time, it was encoding an image with the PNG standard library encoder. If I ask what was it doing here, it was also writing some PNG. And here, what was it doing? It was drawing some pixels with the standard library draw.draw function. So I can see if I have, for example, many gaps in the computation, I know that the processor was waiting for something, for example, the hard drive or the network. If my goal is to maximize the amount of work doing by all the cores of my CPU, I should try to avoid to have too many gaps. So this is really great insight to know what my computer is doing at any given time. PPROF, our next graphical visualization tool. PPROF is the profiling data available out of the box in Go. Let's have a look at the PPROF CPU profiler. The CPU profiling works by sampling. It incurs a relatively small runtime overhead. Every now and then, the kernel sends a CPROF signal, and the special handler of the Go runtime gathers the call trace of one currently running goroutine. The dataset of all these call traces contains some rich statistical information that is used to produce a graph of the functions showing who calls who and how much time is spent in each function, always aggregated. We'll get back to that. So the graph looks like this. You can't see, but we will zoom in a few minutes. This is how we produce the graph. First, we run the benchmark instrumented with CPU profile. And then we run the visualization. In the resulting graph, each box is a function, and it explicitly displays the number of seconds spent inside the code of this function and also inside the functions that are called by this function. Running the benchmark is a very effective way to gather this information because the functions are called many times over a short period of time. At the top, you will find the program's entry point and your own important function. This is the main code that you've been writing. And at the low level, at the bottom, are all the standard library calls and the system calls. The duration for each box consists in the sum of its own CPU time. For example, my function file contains accounted for 89% of the execution time of another program. It's not the mosaic thing, it's another thing. It includes, it is its own CPU time plus the CPU time spent by the function that file content has been calling. This counts only the time actually spent using the CPU, not the time spent waiting for something, waiting for the hard drive or waiting for the network. So I will once again run my benchmarks, the one of the mosaic thing. And this time, instrumenting with pprof. So go test bench. It's small. See, the flag is CPU profile, and I will produce a.prof. Once again, I'm not interested in the numbers. The numbers are a little bit good. I'm interested only in the visualization. Would it help if I zoomed a bit?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. For the syntax, indeed, it's important. Oh, what is that? Okay, so go tool pprof, that's for the web visualization. HTTP 6060, it's optional, it's just that my window here is waiting for 6060. And let's use a.prof. Okay, so what do we have here? I know that the process function, which is my code, took 86% of the total execution time of the benchmark, out of which reading the input files, so from a JPEG that was 12% of the total time here. My own code that is coloring some pixels, so that's my business logic, is colorize cat, and it took only 17% of the total time. And then at the end, encoding the result to a PNG file, to a huge mosaic, took over 50% of the total time. So this is a highly valuable insight. Now I know that the bottleneck is the PNG encoding function. If I wanted to optimize my own code, if I wanted to optimize ColorizeCat, I would only be able to optimize less than 20% of the total execution time. And if I wanted to optimize the PNG encoding, what could I do? I can't really run it concurrently on several CPU cores, because when I'm generating a mosaic, I'm calling PNG encoding only once at the end of the processing. But I know that it is the bottleneck. So, now that I know that the encoding is a bottleneck, I decide to not buffer the output. So what does it mean, not buffer? To not use a bytes.buffer, and I will pass a response writer directly to my processing package. I will show you the processing package in a minute. How much time do we have left? 5 minutes?
Okay.
I should be able to
overlap
a little bit. Sorry. So I will skip some parts. The only advantage of buffering in my previous code was to log the precise number of bytes written, but I can live without it. If I give the response writer directly to the process function, the browser will now receive the stream data as it is being encoded. This is a good UX feedback, because the user sees the first kitties displayed much sooner than before. It also greatly improves the total response time, because the encoding is effectively parallelized with the response data being downloaded by the client. Something that is not the bottleneck is byte shedding. It doesn't deserve some heavy work. I will skip a few slides. Have you heard of flame graphs? Raise your hand. You have not heard of flame graphs? So it's a fancy visualization tool of the profiling data that was invented by Brendan Gregg around 2013. I would demo it. It will be better, I think. So this was produced with the profiling data pprof from my mosaic generation package. And I can view how much time was spent inside each function. For example, I can see the huge span. Here it is the PNG encoding at the end, and I can discover that PNG encoding consists in a function write, a function at, function convert. So what is it about? Function convert. I can dig deeper and deeper to see what actually takes time. So inside the pcrow visualization tool, it's very dynamic. I can see, if I click at the top, I can see everything, and then I can click on more specific spans to discover how comes this was taking time. I had no idea, and now I can discover it, and I can go like, what can I do about it? So it's really a nice visualization tool. It's the same profiling data as pprof, so you will gain similar insight as the graph of the functions that we've seen earlier. And I have prepared an interesting example of why it is different. And so in my example, in the workday and vacation day, both include some sleep and some nightclub and some work and some beach. But if you're in a pprof graph, you don't know if going to the beach was generated, was used by a work day or a vacation day. And with the equivalent flame graph, you can see that sleep is called by a work day, you sleep at night. Sleep is called in a vacation day, you sleep whatever in the morning or midday. But the beach is only stacked under the vacation day span. So you can discover, thanks to the flame graph, that going to the beach is only part of the vacation day. It was not about skipping a day of work. So flame graphs are really beautiful, like a campfire. But most importantly, they are super useful to discover the root cause of some latencies, of some slowness. Yes. OK. A word about concurrency. The gophers, they love concurrency with goroutine and channel and stuff. They are powerful tools to do several things at once and help decrease the total latency of a request. It's still useful even if you have only one CPU core, because not everything is using the CPU. For example, reading to the hard drive or waiting for a network response, it's useful to parallelize and to have some concurrency even if you have only one CPU core. Good to know. And it's super important to run the race detector. If you don't know about the race detector, go check it out. It will run at runtime until and explode, display a big warning if you have a bug of concurrency in your code, because it detects that an illegal data race has occurred when several routines are writing or reading to the same memory location. I don't have time to explain everything today, sorry, but this is really important to use the data race detector. So I have a checklist. I know we don't have a lot of time, but I'll be quick. So what is expensive and what can we do about it? If your code is fast enough, don't try to optimize it too much. It would be evil. If it's not in the hot bath, you don't care about it. Unnecessary processing. If your program is too slow, you will discover that you don't need to call this and that. So please don't do it. You decouple function, you do code reviews, you have a look at pprof, and you discover some processing that you don't need to do. So you just remove them. That's a good advice. Big O. So in my experience, big O analysis is not always helpful. It's not very often the problem. So if you have a code that takes quadratic time or cubic time, obviously you have a problem. But usually between the dirty, slow code and the clean, efficient code, they have the exact same theoretical complexity. So the actual answers to why your programming is slow is in the details. And once again, I have to be quick. So network requests are relatively extremely expensive. So my advice is to make as few requests as possible, not to block everything while waiting for a network response, because that is super expensive, if forgotten. Reading from and writing to the file system is slower than most of what we do in memory and in the CPU. So my advice is to work as much as you can in memory, and once again, you can work in a non-blocking way using concurrency. Contention, because thousands of goroutines waiting for each other is a perfect recipe for unnecessary slowness. So to limit the excessive need for communication between goroutines, I suggest to create workers. And the worker pattern, it looks like this. if you have 4 CPU cores and 1 million computations to perform, so you could launch 1 million goroutines and throw them at the CPUs, but this would have a cost in scheduling and synchronization, and you would end up with contention. So instead, what you can do is to create a small number of worker goroutines, let's say 8, and then have them, each of those worker goroutines, process 1/8 of the total load sequentially. That's much more efficient.
Mm-hmm.
So malloc, asking for memory to the operating system and to the go runtime is notoriously slow. So my advice is to allocate large chunks of memory in one single call to the built-in make function, and to reuse memory by passing buffers as arguments to the processing functions, and also recycling objects with the sync.pool object can be very useful.
Can you comment on that last three parameters, values versus pointers in heapstack?
Here, this one?
Yeah.
Yes, so a lot of the time you have an input to a function and you have an output which consists of memory, for example, generating a huge mosaic, and this takes some memory. If I have many of them to generate, instead of allocating 30 megabytes each time, maybe I would pass a byte buffer to the processing function saying, here is the memory where you will be generating the data, the output, so you don't have to allocate it yourself. So it's a bit similar to the recycling with sync pool pattern, but the important thing is not to call make too often.
And then you just add to it later.
It's not about appending data to a buffer, it's really about reusing a buffer that is already allocated, so overwriting it.
Appending calls basically sometimes memory reallocation, because you need to extend, if you basically allocate big stuff.
Yes, many strategies are very valid, and it's an important topic. Here, for example, if I'm calling append in a loop, that will be slow, that will allocate many times, not as many times as the length of price, but still a few times. If I allocate upfront, then the total it's much faster. So heap or stack, this is not intuitive at all. That some variables will live in the stack and it's almost free, and some other will be allocated on the heap and it's costly. And it's the specification of the Go language doesn't even include the words heap or stack, so the spec doesn't help. It depends if the compiler is clever enough to prove that a variable doesn't escape, so it's safe to put it on the stack. So I won't go into much detail, but if this is already done, and if you have low-level concerns like heap or stack, you can use these parameters of the compiler to discover which variable escape, and those that escape will go to the heap, and that will be slow. And if you can refactor a little bit to leak less references, then it will live on the stack, and it will be faster. I know I'm really quick for some for all of this, but we don't have time, sorry. So regular expressions are usually slow and overkill for a given need. So for example, this uses a regex. It's absolutely illegible, and it's also slower than just using a strings.trim. So my advice is, whenever you can, to avoid regular expressions, you can use the standard library functions in package strings or in package belts, or you can write your own for loop, and it will be much more legible and efficient than the regular expressions. Function calls, sometimes they are inline, sometimes not. So you can ask the compiler, do you think you will inline my code? And you can discover it with this GC flag, which looks similar to the previous one, and chasing the inliner to have it inline a specific function from your hot path, that's become a popular sport. Before I finish, thank you to my colleague David Gageot for the presentation tool Demoid that I'm using today. And here's my takeaway. The Go language was designed for cloud computing with scalability in mind. So its ecosystem is rich and the performance tooling is really good. Now, to improve the experience of your users and make the world a better place, start with an important use case, discover the bottleneck, fix it, and then repeat. Thank you very much for listening.